perceive the past as better than now, cleaner, nicer, not with all the distractions of modern life. And at the centennial time, distractions of modern life included urbanization, industrialization, and immigration. Have you ever heard of that problem? You know, and we keep going over the same things over and over again. And so people took all the colonial stuff that had been relegated to the attic and brought it down and put things out to make things colonial, but with a Victorian twist. And to demonstrate that women's place is in the home, they had spinning wheels up the kazoo, in spite of the fact that in many places, like here, spinning wheels had been relegated to an outbuilding, to the attic, because it was possible to buy fabric, to buy clothing, and you didn't have to make everything at home. But they loved the idea of domestic skills and training women to make a pleasant place for the man who worked outside the home to come home to. And they wanted things to be pretty. And so whenever you had a conflict between history and pretty, guess who won? Pretty. Now there are two words that to me epitomize colonial revival. One is quaint and the other is dainty. I am neither. And when I see a book that I think might fit into my category of awful books, which means colonial revival, I start looking for quaint and dainty, and very often they're on the same page. And then I buy the book and put it in the box with the awful outfit. Clothing was adapted to meet their ideas of what is modest and what is appropriate. And if nobody objected, everybody was happy. And this was very heavily evident in New England for a number of reasons. And I have actually said publicly that New England has co-opted colonial history. And they have explained colonial history in their terms, as if everybody did things the way they did. Well, our farming was different because we could grow things and they grew rocks. And we're not colonial Williamsburg because that's Tidewater, Virginia. That's a very different environment. So colonial revival emphasized New England and Williamsburg. And the gardens matched. And at the centennial, very often a community would acquire a house and do it over the way they thought it should have been done, and then they would do the garden. And it was colonial revival with yards of box and plenty of lavender and parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme, and not a turnip in sight. And everybody was very happy. Now, I had brought a map of a colonial revival garden. I had to buy this. I just had to buy it. I have to remember where I put it.
Upside down.
This is the example.
Upside down.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is the example of a colonial garden at the Museum of American History in